your presence, into your glory, Lord, into your presence, into your glory. I commit my soul, I commit my soul, I commit my soul. Your presence, into your glory, into your presence, into your glory, yes, into your presence, into your glory. I commit my soul, I commit my soul, I consecrate my life, consecrate my life, I commit my soul, I commit my soul, I consecrate my life, I consecrate my life. Oh, into your presence, into your glory, into your glory, yes, into your presence, into your glory, I commit my soul, I commit my soul. Be it unto me according to your word, oh, be it unto me according to your word, oh, be it unto me according to your word, according to your word, oh, be it unto me according to your word, oh, be it unto me according to your word. Oh, be it unto me according to your word, according to your word. Oh, all you said your purposes and all that you commanded. Oh, all you said your purposes and all that you commanded. All you said in purposes, all that you commanded. Oh, be it unto me. Oh, all you said your purposes and all that you commanded. Oh, all you said your purposes and all that you commanded. Oh, all you've said your purposes and all that you commanded. Oh, be it unto me. Oh, be it unto me according to your word. Oh, be it unto me according to your word. Unto me according to your word, according to your word. Oh, be it unto me according to your word. Oh, Lord, be it unto me according to your word. Oh, be it unto me according to your word, according to your word. Oh, all you said your purposes, all that you commanded. Oh, all you said your purposes, all that you commanded. Oh, all you said your purposes and all that you commanded. Oh, be it unto me. Oh, all you said your purposes and all that you commanded. Oh, all you said your purposes and all that you commanded. Oh, all you said your purposes and all that you commanded. Oh, be it unto me. Oh, be it unto me according to your word. Oh, be it unto me according to your word. Oh, be it unto me according to your word, according to your word. promises and all that you've commanded. All you said your purposes and all that you've commanded. All you said your purposes and all that you've commanded. Oh, be it unto me. Oh, be it unto me. According to your word. Oh, be it unto me. According to your word. Oh, be it unto me. According to your word. According to your word. Oh, be it unto me. According to your word. Oh, be it unto me. According to your word. Oh, be it unto me. According to your word. According to your word. Oh, be it unto me. According to your word. Oh, be it unto me. According to your word. Oh, be it unto me. According to your word. According to your word. Be it unto me. Be it unto me. Be it unto me. According to your word. Oh, be it unto me. According to your word, be it unto me, be it unto me, be it unto me, according to your word. Oh, be it unto me, according to your word. Oh, be it unto me, according to your word. Oh, be it unto me. According to your word, according to your word. Wonders that cannot be fathomed, miracles that can't be counted. Would you perform wonders that cannot be fathomed, miracles that can't be counted? Would you perform wonders? Wonders that cannot be fathomed, miracles that can't be counted. Would you perform wonders that cannot be fathomed, miracles that can't be counted? Would you perform wonders that cannot be fathomed, miracles that can't be counted? Would you perform wonders that cannot be fathomed, miracles that can't be counted? Would you perform wonders that cannot be fathomed, miracles that can't be counted? Everlasting, everlasting, everlasting God, you are. Everlasting, everlasting, everlasting God, you are. Everlasting, the everlasting. unsearchable, 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 unsearchable. And full of truth, how majestic are you, O Lord? You are full of grace and full of truth. How majestic are you, O Lord? You're full of grace and full of truth. How majestic are you, Lord? Oh, the depths of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God, unsearchable. Oh, the depths of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God, unsearchable. Oh, the depths of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God, unsearchable, unsearchable. Unsearchable, unsearchable, unsearchable. Oh, your greatness, unsearchable, unsearchable, unsearchable. You are full of grace and full of truth. How majestic are you, Lord? You're full of grace and full of truth. How majestic are you? We're full of grace and full of truth. How majestic are you?
will call upon the Lord while he is near. Oh, I will call upon the Lord. I will call upon the Lord. I will call upon the Lord while he is near. And I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I will seek the Lord continually. I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I will seek the Lord continually. And I will call upon the Lord. Yes, I will call upon the Lord. I will call upon the Lord while he is near. Yes, I will call upon the Lord. Yes, I will call upon the Lord. I will call upon the Lord while he is near. I lift up my voice in praise. I lift up my voice in praise. I lift up my voice. Praise unto your name. I lift up my voice. I lift up my voice. I lift up my voice. Praise unto your name. I will call upon the Lord. Yes, I will call upon the Lord. I will call upon the Lord while he is near. Yes, I will call upon the Lord. Oh, I will call upon the Lord. I will call upon the Lord while he is near.
Your arms so wide, they hold the skies. In your arms so wide, they hold the universe inside. Lord, your arms so wide, they hold the skies. Your arms so wide, they hold the universe. Your arms so wide, they hold the skies. In your arms so wide, they hold the universe inside.
Higher than the highest, greater than the greatest. You're higher than the highest, greater than the greatest, God. You're higher than the highest, greater than the greatest, wiser than the wisest. You are God.
Your arms are wide, they hold the skies. Your arms so wide, they hold the universe inside. Oh, your arms so wide, they hold skies. In your arms so wide, they hold the universe inside.
And you're holding on to me. You're holding on to me. You're holding on to me. Holding on to me. Oh, in this love, this love, this love beyond compare. Oh, this love, this love beyond compare. Oh, this love, this love, this love beyond compare. Oh, this love.
skies. In your arms so wide, they hold the universe inside. Oh, your arms so wide, they hold the skies. In your arms so wide, they hold the universe inside.
And you're holding on.
Oh, this love, this love, this love beyond compare. Oh, this love, this love, this love beyond compare. Oh, this love, oh, this love, this love beyond compare. Oh, this love, this love, this love beyond compare.
This love, this love beyond compare.
Oh, this love, oh, this love, this love beyond compare.
Oh, this love, oh, this love, this love beyond compare.
Oh, this love, oh, this love, this love beyond compare.
So forever will I sing, forever will I sing. Forever will I sing of all you've done for me, Lord. Oh, forever and ever and ever. Oh, forever will I sing, forever will I sing, forever will I sing of all you've done for me. Oh, Lord, mighty, mighty, mighty Savior. Forever will I sing, forever will I sing, forever will I sing of all you've done for me.
You are higher than the highest. Oh, you are higher than the highest. You are greater than the You are wiser than the wisest.
Older than the oldest.
You are older than the oldest.
Stronger than the strongest.
Lord, you are stronger than the strongest.
Oh Lord, we thank you that you accept this praise. We offer to you by the Holy Ghost, higher than the highest, wiser than the wisest, older than the oldest, greater than the greatest, stronger than the strongest. Lord Jesus, we glorify you. We thank you for the rain of your presence, Lord. Lord Jesus, we worship you. Name above every name, Lord Jesus, name above every name, Lord Jesus, power above every power, Lord Jesus, greater than the grave. This thing higher than anything, Lord Jesus, name above all names, Lord Jesus, name above all names, Lord Jesus, power above every power, Lord Jesus, greater than the greatest thing. Lord Jesus, wiser than the wisest. Lord Jesus, older than the oldest. Lord Jesus, we worship you. Lord Jesus, we worship you. Lord Jesus, we worship you. We call upon your name. We call upon your name. Lord, you reign. Lord Jesus, we call upon your name. The movings of your spirit now, we call upon your name. Lord Jesus Christ, we worship you. Lord Jesus, our God, we worship you. Lord Jesus, our Savior, we worship you. Lord Jesus, our Redeemer, we call upon your name. Lord Jesus Christ, our God. Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior. Lord Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. We call upon your name. Call upon your name, your reign, oh God. Your fire now, your glory, Lord. Jesus, Lord Jesus. Call upon your name, Redeemer. We call upon your name, our Savior. We call upon your name, living God. Your fire now, your glory and your fire. Glory now, your mighty power, your glory now, Lord Jesus Christ, Lord our Savior, Lord Jesus Christ, Lord living God, Lord Jesus Christ. Our Redeemer, Lord Jesus Christ, forever you're the same. And we worship you, oh God, we worship you. Worship you, oh Lord. Father, we come by this new and living way. Father, that you made for us in Jesus. Father, Father, we come by this new and living way. Father, that you made for us by Jesus. By the blood of Jesus Christ. By the blood of the Lamb. The veil, the glorious veil of your temple. Your body and your flesh. Holy Spirit, take control. Holy Spirit, we yield to your rivers. Holy Spirit, come and take control. Holy Spirit, we yield to your rivers. Glorify, reveal Jesus now. Glorify, glorify. Reveal Jesus now. Holy Spirit, come and take complete control. Let your rivers flow. In this place, reveal Jesus now. In this place, reveal Jesus now. In my life, in my life, reveal Jesus now. In my life, in my life, reveal Jesus now. Holy Spirit, we yield to you. Holy Spirit, ourselves to you. In this place, reveal Jesus now. Lord, in this place, reveal Jesus now. In my life, in my life, reveal Jesus now. Lord, in my life, reveal Jesus now. Holy Spirit, we yield to you. Holy Spirit, we yield ourselves to you. In this place, reveal Jesus now. In this place, reveal Jesus now. Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit, yield ourselves to you. Holy Spirit, yield ourselves to you.
Certain that the Holy Spirit desires to take us into a realm where He can show us holiness much holier than we thought. God would like us to come and view a love much more lovely than we've ever understood. To come behold a glory that takes all of our other definitions and insights completely away. Father is so interested in bringing us in to behold Him in His glory. I look at the little bit of information that we have, but yet the little information we have is amazing about what it's like to stand before the throne of God, what it's like to look upon His face. It's so amazing. It's so wonderful. Heaven and earth will flee away from it if his disposition is angry. It's so glorious and so holy and so beyond all that can be comprehended. No man has ever been able to stare into this face. Christ Jesus came and revealed the Father, but prior to that, No one was ever able to see him in all of his glory. It's just too majestic. It's just too wonderful. It's just too full of life. It's just too full of purity. It's just too full of holiness. It's just too glorious. I mean, Moses, in the position that he was able to have with the Father, because not of what Moses did, because of God's just grace, because God said, come near to me. Wouldn't it be amazing if the Lord looked at you and said, come near to me? And he made it all happen. Because he sought you and he searched you, and he found in you a person that was willing to obey him and respond. You know, I'm amazed at the grace that was poured out upon Paul's life. But one of the great responses of Paul was, the grace wasn't given to me in vain. I labored more than them all. I took what God gave, and I went with it, and it consumed my whole life. And I counted everything that I had as dung, and I suffered the loss of everything just to be able to win this one I encountered on the road to Damascus. Moses, in that grace, he sought the Lord that he could see him in his glory. He so laid hold upon a place of being able to prevail with God that God said, couldn't say no to him entirely. He said, you can't see my face and live. And Moses didn't seem to be troubled about that at all. He was very acquainted already with the all-consuming fire of Almighty God, as he was the one who beheld for the first time something that man's eyes had never seen, as the bush burned but yet was not consumed, as he heard the audible voice of God speaking out of the midst of the fire. I mean, Abraham had a little touch of it when the fire, the burning lamps passed between the sacrifice, but it was nothing like this. You could see his heart, his life literally lit up, as a call upon the altar of God, burning with a desire and a passion to behold more of that which charged, supercharged his being with the adrenaline and with the ecstasy of eternity and of the ages. Beseeching God, it was the highest high, it was the greatest event, it was the most glorious thing. It's where every part of his being began to live the way that God had purposed it to live, and it was beyond all that men could imagine of breathing and of living and of functioning and of being a being. He said before the bush that burned, and he said, how will I prove to them that you've sent me? He said, I tell you what, once you go, you can come back here and see me again. So it was worth all the risk. I'm not going to give you any proofs beyond the signs and the wonders. I'm not going to tell you anything else. But the big reward for you for seeking me and obeying me, being willing to hear me and obey me, is you get to come back and visit with me again. I personally believe that the proper way to translate I am that I am is, hey, it's really me. It's me. It's really me. And the one your great, 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 great grandfather walked away from. It's really me. I'm your creator. I'm the one who loves you so much. I'm the one who created you and fashioned you after my image and after my likeness. It's really, really me. It's me. Oh, si patel, father's crying out, Adam, where you at? Moses comes back and he's got such a place with God, the father can't say no to that which is impossible for any man to see. He said, I'll tell you what, I'll give mercy to those whom I give mercy to, and I will give grace to those whom I just choose to give grace to. So I'll make a room for you here and placed in this cleft, this hollowed out area on the side of the cliff. And I'll pass before you and I will shout out my name. Whew. Whew. I declare to you who I am. Boy, what a display of love and mercy and glory. What a display of grace and long suffering. Whoa, what a display of faithfulness. When I pass by, you may look up. And Moses beheld something that the rest of us are going to have to wait to begin to see until that day when the corruptible puts on the incorruptible. When as the sons of God, we see him as he is, for we shall be like him. What an amazing promise. But there's something that God wants to do right now. The blood of Jesus Christ, giving the blood full privileges and full rights and full power and full effect and full authority over our lives, would cause us to step into the holies of holies with all boldness, come in through a new living way, through the royal garments of his flesh, and there behold the Almighty, the face and the glory of the living God, and there change from glory to glory, to behold as in a mirror the image. And there, beholding that image, beholding that glory that Moses had to veil his face with, that New Testament glory, that end of the law, that end of estrangement, that end of separation, that end of otherness. Father wants to make the sacred far more sacred than we ever thought it to be. Father wants to make his presence far more impacting and paralyzing than we ever thought it to be. And he's just waiting for the proper response of hunger and the diligence that says, I'm going to seek your face continually. And I'm so blessed that we're getting ready to have meetings 3 nights in a row here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because I tell you right now, I'm just interested in waiting. God, I see a world that is interested in seeing somebody lead them into the presence of the living God, to learn how to wait upon God, to stop making it common and everyday and ordinary, just to hear the same old secular stuff going on in a religious context. And God's going to raise up his people who stood before his presence and beheld his glory and received those things from heaven that Jesus displayed, that George Whitefield touched, and it caused people to tremble and quake under the power of God. You know, my great aunt, one of my relatives, great great aunt, in 1657, her and Anne Hutchinson and a few other people up in Rhode Island, on the day of Pentecost, it was Pentecost day that day. And they were praying, they were crying out to God for a move of the Spirit in the colonies, in the Massachusetts colonies, and they were just dealing with the religious strongholds of the Puritans, trying to legislate upon them the same things that were already going down in England with the Anglican Church and with all the stuff that they had been delivered out of. And they're crying out to God for Pentecostal fire to fall upon the colonies. And it's recorded. And you can see this and you can research this. It's easy to find this information. The greatest earthquake ever recorded in the eastern United States. And you couldn't tell them that was a coincidence. It wasn't then, but within a year, that they hung Mary, one of my relatives, they hung her in the Boston, Massachusetts House of Commons, because she was a Holy Ghost woman. They banished Anne Hutchinson into the wilderness. They tried to stop the move of God, but the move of God, just all it did is just got kindled as religion, and it fought. It was religion fighting against the power of God. It's always been working that way. You know, that's the formation of this nation. It has nothing to do with the president. Has nothing to do with the president. It has nothing to do with the Congress. It has nothing to do with the Senate. It has nothing to do with the Supreme Court. This nation was founded
by the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ in 1620 at Plymouth Rock. There landed upon those shores people hungry and desperate for the things of God, whose purpose was to seek God, to have a place where the church could thrive and grow and be a lighthouse in the world. That's who we are. We just lost who we are. And when the church has turned away from God and has taken up a progressive liberal agenda, then there is no power to make a disciple out of a nation. Just a few years ago in the 40s, no movie was made in Hollywood unless the church gave its approval. And there was nobody elected to an official office unless they could show that they had a reverence and a fear for the living God. But everything's been changed so radically, and if there's ever been a time for a turning back to God and an understanding of holy reverence and a holy fear, it's now. Today we live in a climate that if you start talking about the judgment against sin and the judgment against iniquity, you are labeled as a preacher of condemnation and labeled as a shame to the church. That there's no place for the righteous to stand. How shall sinners be converted? If there's no righteousness in the church, then how can a nation be turned back to righteousness? I'm so glad that you're going to be here with us for 3 days. You know, we're so blessed, so honored to have Evangelist Tim Hall here. And he's walked with the Lord for many years. And I mean, seen great signs and wonders and great miracles. And the beautiful thing about it is he's just as hungry for God now as he's ever been. You know, the reality of it is Australia is in a bigger mess than the United States of America. Europe is just as big as a mess. We've turned the glory of God into shame. We haven't turned the glory of God into the image of four-footed beast as Israel did. We've made it worse in some respects. I'm not going to go into the negative part of it all. I'm just going to say that the Lord wants to come visit us. I know that the Lord's stirring Evangelist Tim's heart into a realm of just, you know, talking about the power and the authority of God and sensitivity towards that and moving with the Spirit of the Lord. And, you know, that's the calling card of God. But the fact of it is, dear people, there is no proofs and evidence of being born again as the evidence of righteousness and holiness and purity and intimacy and relationship with the Father. If there's anything that's got to happen, is the sacred's got to become sacred again. The holy has got to become holy again. The righteous has got to become righteous again. The presence of God has got to become something to tremble in. George Whitfield took a hold of a little bit of it. He just had a revelation one day when he was there in Oxford, out on the picnic area of Oxford. He gets a little bit of a revelation that man must be born again by the Holy Spirit. That was his revelation. And he took that revelation. You think, wow, you mean tell me in the early 1700s? That was a revelation? It was a revelation. He was a part of a holy club, Anglican holy club, but they had no concept of what it meant to be born again. They had no concept, really, of what John chapter 3 was about. And he's sitting there on a bench in Oxford, in the park, reading John chapter 3, gets a revelation, man must be born again, born of the Spirit and born of the water. He begins to preach this. God so honored the message that people shook and quaked under the power of Holy Ghost conviction. I remember sitting around the table when I was young and listening to all the ministers lament along with my dad about how Holy Ghost conviction had left the church. That was in the 60s. I really didn't understand what they were talking about. For me, I mean, you know, all we're just basically a product, really, of our experience, of our culture, of our, you know, of our social interactions. But as I look back now being 57 years old, looking back over the history of the church, seeing the place, this critical juncture that we're in, I have a little bit more understanding of the shift that took place in the 50s and the 60s. It took place globally. It took place in the United States of America. And reality of it is, it took place first in the church. The church started backsliding and falling away from God. The church started making it about their own individual social agenda and merchandise of the people and running after fame instead of being hidden in the glory. New doctrines begin to spring up and begin to be emphasized by the early 70s that never existed in the church. Never existed. Just simply never existed in the church. And I'm not going to go into itemizing those things. You know, everybody can study them. And if you want references to books and, you know, good folks who've done great research in these various different things, I'm happy to refer them to you. Bigger issue is us right now interfacing with the call of God upon our life, presence of the Holy Spirit here, the call for us to come and live out the life of Jesus and walk in His ministry, and how we're going to respond to that, and how we're going to move beyond the social constraints, cultural constraints, religious constraints, and rather be constrained by God. Hallelujah. In a very narrow place. A very narrow place. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Is God so good? You know, He loves us in spite of all of our failings and all of our faults and all of our distractions and all of our immaturity and unwillingness to mature. But it doesn't take away His desperation to see somebody make a move. It seems like people like to just revel in the fact that God is just so patient and long-suffering with those who are just constantly messing up. That's not anything to make you boast about. You know what I'm saying? Praise God, we are His covenant people. But God demands obedience of His covenant people. There are a lot of people, I would say probably even a tithe in the United States of America, maybe 30 million people that attend church who are willing to hear. But there's not that many people that are willing to be obedient. What happens is just a few really begin to see God. It just took a few. Every great revival you ever see, it just took a few. The beginning, 120, just took a few. 120 in Pentecost, just took a few. Just a couple of champions. James was so radical, they had to kill him right away. They tried to kill John lots of times, but it didn't work. Paul was so radical. Come on now. And you think about it. Paul is an example to you and me of being able to fully lay hold on the life and ministry of Jesus. And of being a person who even the aged Paul would say that I may know Him. He never lost his passion. He never lost his hunger. He never got distracted. He never lived on his laurels. He never talked about what happened in the day. It was like the aged Paul, that I may know Him. The power of His and the fellowship of His suffering be made conformable unto His death. That if by any means I too might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Hey, we're just going to pursue the Lord. We're going to go after Him. Forget about religion. If you got a problem with love, get that straightened out tonight. Because you can't even begin with God. You're sitting around with criticism and feeling all hurt and offended, and you're just weird. And God, the Holy Ghost, has come to make whole people out of weird folks that are just all messed up from offense and rejection and the issues of a demonized world. God, the Holy Ghost, will move in and just fill you with love. You'll lose your opinion. I praise God tonight. Actually, the Greek word for opinion is heresy. You'll lose your heresy. Praise God. And you'll start speaking the word only. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Yeah, you know, the Lord has promised us, and we've labored in it for 35 years, a great shaking in Southern California. You know, we're just excited about it as I've ever been. I was excited about it as when I first came the first year coming under and, you know, being in San Diego with a bunch of folks saying, God's going to do these great things, and I'm not going to go into all the details of it. God's going to do these great, great things. And I thought it was going to happen the first year. You know, here we've had some amazing events that's happened over the past 35 years. That's some amazing. People wonder, how is it that we get such property? You know, going from the huge property we had on the Naval Training Base and running wide open for those number of years there. And, you know, 6 acres here, $15 million property. How do you guys do it? You know, you could create some serious conspiracy theories around me. Because everybody takes a little bit of anecdotal information and, you know, goes to seed with it, right? Hey, God, supernatural living God, who says, I set you in a large, large place. I've given you a voice and nobody can take the microphone away from you. You're the only one. You can lay it down if you want to. And You know, I've had some opportunities to lay it down. I was just in a place just recently, just last week, and one person after another, one man of God after another said, it's about to happen. It's about to happen. Get ready. It's about to happen. The thing, it's about to explode, Mark. It's about to explode. It's about to go. You know, we might get frustrated with the tryings of the Lord, how he tries us and how he prepares us and how he examines us. He doesn't examine us to prove us wrong. He examines us to make us right. Examines us to make us right. Doesn't examine us to prove us wrong. He examines us to make us right. To be conformed to the image of the Son in every way. We may get a little bit discouraged with it and overwhelmed by it. But listen, people, just keep doing what Christ Jesus called us to do. Keep speaking what God's placed within our mouth to say. Huh? Just be faithful. I had a guy come up to me in the meeting I was in last week, and he said, you know, I watch all your School of Spirit and on and on and on, going through the list. He said, give me one word from the Lord. And I were rushing on our way out the door, completely sleep exhausted. I said, you want one word from the Lord? I said, be faithful in what God's given you to do. You just be faithful, you'll win. Who, I don't care who you are tonight, you just be faithful, you win. You jump around, you do all your little whatever, you're not winning nothing. But maybe getting saved by the skin of your teeth. But I'm talking about people who want to be champions in God. Just be faithful. Don't tell God how to do it. Huh? Hello? Don't start talking to the potter. Just be faithful. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Tim, are you going to use the, you guys forgive me. Well, I want you to tell you something. You just understand. When I say Tim to Tim, I'm not being disrespectful. You shouldn't call him Tim. You should call him something more respectful. But, I mean, I really look at him as an overseer in this church. I look at him as a father in the faith. I look at him as someone who's he's been so good to us and dear to me. It was in Tim's crusade. It was the first time I ever got to step into a place in God to minister to multitudes and multitudes. There was probably 30,000 people there that night. And, you know, it's Friday night. It's the big night. Tim says to me, you're on. And I said, like, wait, it's the big night. You're on. Thanks, Tim, for being an example, for loving us so much. Do you want to use this one or do you want to use this one? You want a mic? Well, then you need to turn the mic up because you might hear it really good there, but we need a little bit of extra here. And just be mindful of that. If you see anybody holding their ears, putting their fingers in there, that's a sign. You can't have, of course, some people putting their fingers in the ears and other people going, turn it up. Sweet presence of Jesus. Hey, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Listen, tonight I want you to get ready to give at the end, towards the end of the meeting. We like to do it at the end of the meeting. I figure people are more in the flow of what God wants them to do at the end of the meeting. And, you know, all this week, tonight, Thursday night, Friday night, we're going to be receiving an offering that's going to go to Tim Hall Ministries, and because we just want to be a part of everything he's doing. Amen?
Thank you, Reverend. You're the man. Walk around. Howdy, folks. How are you? Are you all well? Oh, it's good to. Where's Jude the dude? How you going, Jude the dude? Where's your brothers? Hey, I got some interesting news for the kids. For all you kids here. I've been so inspired sitting here year after year drawing 18 million cartoons until I'm totally exhausted and Pastor Mark is begging me to leave and saying, Tim, the sun's rising and you're just drawing your 49th kangaroo. Well, I said to the Lord, I've drawn so many cartoons for so many people, I must have sown some seed of blessing. And so I'm now producing the amazing animal alphabet book of coloured cartoons. And what I might do in the next night or so is show you two samples. You've been eating well. We've got babies happening around here. Where's Ruth Ann? Okay, bring the child. I must.
I wasn't even aware. That's because I'm getting a bit. Look at this, Ruthie. Look at you, a mum. I was over here for your school graduation and I. What a little shook. Oh no. Look at this. Hello, Tiger. She's wearing Where's Wally? He's wearing Where's Wally. Does he look comfortable? There you are. Oh, how handsome are you? Just make some little baby noises for us, yeah?
I know.
Look at that. I might just preach on the job. Hey, good job, guys. Oh, nice work. And exactly, praise God. I'll hand back. I can't really preach like this. Ruthie, you're a mother. You used to be a little kid. You're like one of these little ditches around the place. Got some stories, and I was here for your graduation from college, graduation from school.
Now I'm here to. What a cute babe. Well done, Kate. Well done. Did you go in for the birth? Isn't it? So did you do the blowing? It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. We make out we're really helping. We're useless. Males are useless. We think we're so tough. Honestly. And then the ladies have the baby, and the next day you go in to see them with the baby, and they sit up there with a shawl, and they look at all the men, and they go, you guys think you're so tough. Try this. Try this. That's true. And if you're a male, you go, I don't want to. No, I'm not interested. Is he a good father, Kate? Is he a doting father? So this is your first grand boy. So this three. I know. I noticed. I noticed. I just didn't want to say. You know. People have been expecting me to have twins for years. Hey, it is so good to be here. It's like a family here. It's been a lot of years, and it's been a lot of fun. But it's also we've shared. I come here about once a year, and it's selfish, really. Josh, What about Dan? They're not expecting anything up there. Yeah, I know, but they're not no babies or anything. Come on, Dan. Come on, Dan. But I like to come in here and I get with Mark and then immediately have to go home and study like mad to show myself approved. I mean, I was silly enough to open up. I opened up something today. What was it now? Oh, yeah, we just got into some Revelation stuff and I just threw out some really good ones. And then I sat back and went, And he used some terms in the Hebrew, like this is the and the like I'm supposed to know. And so, exactly. And then coming here, we had a long debate, our discussion. So we could have been discussing football, the weather, but no, we're discussing, is it going to be Enoch or Moses, one of the two witnesses, and Mark says, well, you think this, prove it scientifically. Now, he said, okay, you've got to prove this, and then I realised I'm here with the scientist, so now I agree with him 100%, so I just gave up. It wasn't worth it. It wasn't worth it. And, we used to get out and get with the boys, it was like a tradition to go out there and just shoot stuff, just rocks, dirt, shoot dirt with all these guns. I mean, we, in Australia, we have, you know, BB guns and slingshots. But here, everyone's got guns. Everybody's got guns. In Texas, you can wear one. Get around with a sidearm. It's a different country. Different country. Good old US of A. You want my guns? You can prize them out of my cold, dead fingers. I was just over in the Carolinas, in Northern Carolina, and I learned that there's no R in Carolina. It was just, I'm here in the Carolinas. And I've learned that stare, I went downstairs. I said, how do you spell that? Stairs. About the same as you spell grays. America's an incredible country. But there is a level of madness going on. We've been watching the elections. I mean, we're not going that well ourselves. We've had five prime ministers in 6 years. And what went really close was that we had our treasurer was called Costello. Well, he pulled out a few years ago, just before Abbott became prime minister. But if he'd stayed as treasurer, we would have had Abbott and Costello. So it's politics. And America's future doesn't hinge on the election. That's a Rodney. It hinges on the church. It hinges on the church. It does hinge on the church. I feel the presence of God here. I feel the power of God. Last time I was here, I was talking, I believe I was talking from 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3. How many remember that that's what I was speaking from? How many remember what I was speaking about? Well, that was a waste of time. What was it, Kate? Catalambano. Catalambano. It's a good word, isn't it? Catalambano. Did I preach on apprehending that for which I was apprehended? You've got four house marks and a trip to Garang Garang on the school bus with a cut lunch. I just feel so good. I feel like standing up here and just feeling good for a minute. Isn't life good? I'm starting to wonder if I really live in the way you're supposed to approaching 70. I don't know. How are you supposed to? In the last 8 weeks, we've been in New Orleans, Tampa, Bogota, South America. Big church, huge church down there, 50,000 people. Dallas, flew home. Japan, Tokyo, with people coming in from Taiwan and coming in from Hiroshima and Nagasaki and Kyoto. And we had a phenomenal time preaching there and went to the Disney there, which was very humorous. Japanese Disney. I was walking around Japan and they're very serious. And as I was walking along, I'd just walk up behind people and they'd look, and I'd turn around as well. What was that? And just disturbing Tokyo. We disturbed Tokyo and had a lot of fun there. A few pranks. And then we came back from there and I flew straight from Tokyo back to Australia, got on a plane, straight to New Guinea, to Moresby, straight to Lae, got out, put my preaching gear on and went straight to the pulpit and preached a big crusade meeting that night and the next night and the next night. And I was so wet that I could take my shirt and wring it out. And then 60,000 people in the stadium on the Friday night, and then across to Vanuatu, city of 46,000, and we finished up with just under 20,000 of the 46 in the meetings. Took a team of 100 with us, and over the course of a week, they saw 2,000 major miracles, and one of our teams saw 30 deaf healed over the week. And flew home, and been home 3 weeks, and in that 3 weeks, it's been pretty quiet. I've painted 28 paintings, finished my second book, which is coming out soon. Should I send a box over? Yeah. It's my story. Yeah, first 40 years of ministry. I tell all sorts of stories in there. It's going to be interesting reading, and I go into all the miracles we've seen, and it's there to inspire and stir. And plus, we're finishing the cartoon book, and so 28 paintings, finished the book, got it published, cartoon book on the way. Now we're back in America, and then I'm thinking, I feel a bit weary. But the beautiful thing is that when we get home, in 9 days, we've got an exhibition, so I've got to finish off a bunch of paintings that week, do the exhibition, and then back on a plane to Stockholm, Paris. That's going to be a real struggle, preaching in Paris, taking my wife over, and it's preaching, but I've got 5 days in Paris, and we're going to just stroll around and romantically walk around the Eiffel Tower and parler le français en Paris. Near the Moulin, no, not the Moulin Rouge, you won't go near that. Lac de Triomphe, Le Louvre, c'est bien, mange la grenouille, let's go. C'est magnifique, Pepe Le Pew. And then we'll go on to London and preach in London and then up to Manchester and then come home and have Christmas. 110 degree Christmas, it'll be just beautiful. It always feels like Christmas. Sitting around in a t-shirt and shorts, eating Christmas pudding, hot Christmas pudding. It's incredible. You just the snow and anyway, that's just a hello. Good to see. It's nice to see. I just feel like going up to everybody. How are you? What's happening? What's the latest? And all that. Look at all the kids. They're all growing up. They all get a bit taller. Josh and Caleb, hair's getting redder. He saw my hairstyle, new hair. Well, this is the old hairstyle, just pushed it back, bit of Elvis. And word got around, and there's a few imitators here tonight. I want to share with you, I enjoy a laugh, some of you know that. Someone said, how do you get through, this is my 40th year of ministry, we've been all over the world, it's been insane at times. It's been phenomenal. It's been amazing. I guess in the last 8 weeks, we've probably seen about 25,000 saved. And it's a great life. It's a great life. And we're planning stuff that next year. Crowds, anything up to 1 million people we're expecting in one crusade and stuff in India. And then they tell me how much it's going to cost. And then I panic and then I just go to God. But I want to finish this life in a blast, a furious blast. I want to just hit the end of this thing, and I'm fat, but Mum was fat. She lived to 99 years 10 months. She was fat. She was really fat. She died 2 months short of 100. And someone says, you won't live long. I say, well, Mum did, and I'm going to. All these skinny guys are dropping. They're just dropping off the perch. These skinny blokes out running and they're got the headband on, running, go home, drop dead. Not me. I just work on the old dog principle. You know the old dog principle? The young dogs run around the backyard chasing the cats, racing up, jumping up on the fence, racing around. The old dog lies on the porch, looking around, waiting for the postman. All the young dogs are racing up the yard. They're chasing cars, chase a bus. What would ever happen if they caught it? Grabbed it by the tire. But the old dog just lies there because he knows that he just needs that bit of energy. And then he hears the whistle blowing. Do you still have postmen? They've been bitten by a lot of dogs, those guys. And you hear him getting closer. The heart starts to beat. The postman arrives and you charge, attack, rip a big piece out of his trousers. The postman takes off screaming. You go back on the porch with a big piece of postman trouser hanging from your teeth. And the young dogs came around and said, what happened? What happened? What? We've been very busy racing around. What happened? Strategically took the moment. So that's a help to probably no one. Is this being... Are people watching this? All right, I better preach. Hello, folks. It's just a family reunion. Just having a chat with everybody. So isn't it great as Christians that we can enjoy each other? I look around, there's so many stories, so many. Where's the other Nakase kids? Where are they all hiding? They're what? For how long? They just better be. Otherwise they'll be hunted. I want to talk just for a little while tonight about living supernaturally in a hostile world. Father, would you anoint this next little while? And Father, would you stir us and take us to another dimension? You're doing something powerful in us. We do give you praise. We give you praise. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. I want you to turn your Bible, please, to 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Does anyone remember that I went there last time? No? Oh, that's good. It's really exciting when you've just been here a few months ago and no one remembers anything you said. You know that the impact must have been incredible. Paul is writing to the Corinthian church, and sometimes we start, I would start at verse 3, but I want to just look at the preceding verses because Paul is writing to the Corinthian church. And obviously the Corinthian church had its own style. The Corinthian church had its favorite preachers. Some loved Apollos. Some loved Paul. I'm of Paul, I'm Peter, I'm of Apollos, I'm of whoever. And they were certainly carnal in many ways. They were loaded with the gifts of the Spirit, but they had their own carnal ways. And there were those that loved Paul and those that thought he was a bit pathetic. And when I read some of the things they thought about him and get some of the things that people have called me and thought about me over the years, I feel pretty good. They wrote and they said, Paul says, "Now I, Paul, myself, beseech you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ." He said, "I'm coming to you. I'm writing to you in the meekness of Jesus, who in presence am base amongst you." He says, I'm unimpressive amongst you. Apparently, Paul was not impressive, and he had a very large nose. Nothing wrong with a large nose. How many people would say that you've got a reasonably large proboscis? Is that the right word? Is that a nose, a proboscis? Or is that the name of a monkey? Is that the Latin word for nose? Have I beaten you on that one? Napoleon wouldn't have a man in his army as a general unless he had a good-sized hooter. You'd get a good rank. You'd be in. You'd go fairly well. Who else got a reasonable-sized nose? He was not that big. He'd be a private. How about you, Stu? You got a bit of a honker on there. Yeah, you'd be high ranking, field marshal, something like that. No, you wouldn't. Oh, you got a good nose, Stuart. I've offended him. Stuart's looking at me like, "I don't like you. I used to like you." But apparently he was fairly unimpressive to look at. And it seems he may not have been the dynamic preacher that Apollos was. Apollos certainly was a man that could preach the word of God. But we do want one thing about Paul was that he carried an incredible anointing of power. So when I came amongst you, he said, "I was in fear and trembling." Much fear, much trembling. But he says, "I determined something, and that was that I would know nothing amongst you save Christ and him crucified." He says, "I'm in weakness. He said, when I came amongst you, my preaching was not with the persuasive words of the wisdom of men. It wasn't about my technique or my delivery or whether I was a good communicator. He said, my preaching was not with the persuasive words and well put together words, although he was an incredible wordsman. As we read his letters, he was a master of language. But he said, I didn't come with persuasive words, but I came in the power and the demonstration of the Spirit, that your faith may not rest on the wisdom of men, but on the power of God. And I want people, when I'm dead and gone, pushing up daisies somewhere and someone brings up your name, I don't want to be remembered for someone who just preached some good sermons. I want to be remembered as someone who, everywhere they went, deposited something of the tangible of God. I asked the Lord years ago, he said, what do you want to do? I said, I want to be a preacher. He said, I've got plenty of them. And he has. He said, I'm looking for men and women of God. Now I'll let you in on a secret. They can be very different. I hear a lot of preachers. And as they preach, you're hearing a whole lot of great words and a great concepts. But you're wanting more than that. You're wanting something that gets down in here and grips your spirit. Something that harpoons. Jesus said, John 6:63, said, the words that I speak to you, they are spirit and they are life. I want to preach spirit and life. I want something to happen. I want faith to rise. I want people to get stirred. I want them to get motivated. I want the word to be alive and living and sharp and active and sharp in the two-edged sword, cutting the fine line between soul and spirit, joint and marrow, even cutting to the fine line of thoughts and intentions of the heart. Paul's writing and he says, I might not be that impressive. He said, I beseech you, I may not be bold when I'm present with you. I might be gentle or meek, and I may present an ordinary attitude when I'm with you. And some of you think as though we just walked in the flesh, as though we're just ordinary people. We're just of the sarks, of the natural, that we're just not really carriers of much. We're just ordinary people amongst you. But Paul says, but it's true that we walk in the flesh. We do walk in the flesh. The word walk there is prepateo, which means walk around. That's our, we just get around in the flesh. I don't know how many of you got up this morning and realized that you're in a body that you can't get out of. You live in it. You live in this thing. I realize that this mine has its challenges. When I tried to get up into Pastor Mark's truck at the airport, I had to have five people lift me up and get me in, and then I needed a parachute to get out. But that's another story. And walking around airports, you're very aware. And what is it about American airports? What is it about them? You walk 6 miles to the gate, and then over the speaker, those flying to such and such, please know that your gate has been moved from Z58 back to L92. Boarding has commenced. Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you very much. And you walk and walk and walk and walk and walk and walk. And wherever you land, it's the furthest distance from the baggage. I landed in one place. I needed a camel and a water bag to get down to the baggage area. And he died of starvation. Fortunately, some dear old lady gave me a sandwich on the way back, and I was able to, and I was nourished. For though we walk around in the flesh, Paul says, we don't war after the flesh. He says, you guys might just see us, but you don't realize that we are in a warfare. The word there is stratomeia, is that correct, Pastor? Stratomeia, which is like a campaign of war. He said, though we walk in the flesh, we are in a campaign that is not of the flesh. We're, if And I think he's saying to them, you may see us one way, but we'd love you to get a glimpse of just what life's about. We'd love you to get a glimpse of the fact that we are not warring after the flesh, but in the spirit realm, it is unto the death. Most Christians in most churches have little or no idea that they are involved in a military campaign. It's a campaign where the enemy in every way wants to bring your church down, your family down, your home, your children, your nation. I'm going through stuff at the moment. My daughter came out of a chronic situation some years ago. Chronic situation. We prayed, we sought God, pressed into God day after day after day. And in the last 18 months, the family, it's like a tornado of destruction has gone through the home of my eldest daughter, enough to break your heart. And you realize that all of a sudden, I've let go a little in prayer in that situation, and the enemy just waited to get back into that thing. And it's time to once again press in, because in the spirit realm, the devil's come to kill, steal, and destroy. How many are glad that greater is he that lives in us than he that's in the world? You see, we are in a warfare. And if we're not aware of that, if we're not aware that every day we got to stand strong, and every day we've got to be armed and equipped, then we're vulnerable. But this is full of positivity. We'll look at that in a moment. Just jump over to Ephesians and chapter 6. We're all familiar there. And I've preached on the armor of God here previously, so we don't need to go there again. But if we go over to Ephesians chapter 6, which is a problem in my Bible because the page has fallen out and is not there. So I've got to try and remember it. But it says this, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord. That word in dunamu, be supernaturally infused. Basically, in dunamu is, as I read it, in, and the base word dunamis, be in the dynamic supernatural ability and miraculous power and capacity of God. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. The two words there, kratos, which is eruptive, which is dominion. It's really the dominion of God. This is a eruptive, demonstrative demonstration of his dominion and power. The sort of power that it says in Ephesians 1 is the same power that was exerted in the dead body of Jesus when God raised him from the dead. That's kratos power. And then the word iskos, which is forcible strength. The powerful words, and Paul strings them together. He seems to want to say, when he talks about power, he talks about God's dominion and mighty, unstoppable, forceful, majestic, unstoppable, unlimited power when he talks about, because he wants us to understand that it's the same power, he says in Ephesians 1, according to the working of his mighty power, which was exerted in the body of Jesus when God raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places, far above all rule, principality, power, and dominion, put all things under his feet, which is the church, who is the fullness, the pleroma, the overflowing fullness of him that fills all and in all. And you hath he quickened by the same power, who were dead in trespass and sin. And verse 5 says, and joined together, and raised together, and seated together. Joint heirs, one spirit with him. The same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead has come to indwell you and I. Paul says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God. Whole armor, the Greek word panoplia, from two Greek words, pass all, hoplon, weaponry. That's not a statement to be defensive. The Romans didn't get dressed up, put on all their gear and go, it's really going to be a great defensive day today. We're just going to take a stand and we'll just handle everything they throw at us. The Roman is sharpening his sword, saying, I'm going to use this weapon today in a very significant way. I'm coming through. You don't put on the whole armor of God to just whistle Dixie. Da da dum dum da 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 dum 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 da 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 da. Look away, look away, look away, look away, away down south in Dixie. Hurrah, hurrah! It's all right. I've just been in Virginia. Don't mind. I was just in Virginia and North Carolina. It's just down in Richmond. I was in Jefferson Davis's house. He wasn't there, but I was there, looking around. The Romans didn't put on the whole armor of God just for a game. They dressed up in the full armor with the full weaponry. That word there, armor, is a little bit, I find it a bit negative. Put on the whole armor, be endued into or clothed into the full weaponry of a fully armed Roman legionnaire, that you might stand against the wiles of the devil. The word wiles, methodius, methods, plans, mind games. He knows the greatest battle we're ever going to have is going to be mind games of the devil. The greatest victory we have to overcome to go to the next place in God is to overcome the negativity that the enemy throws that says you can't do it. The biggest enemy much of the time is allowing the devil's thoughts to be the ones we accept rather than the God thoughts. The Bible says, be ye transformed in the spirit of your mind. Transformed. Put on the whole armor of God that you might be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Now, I don't want to give the devil any glory, but he's very real. But the big truth is that if we stand strong and don't compromise, as in the days of Balaam, he cannot touch us. No curse shall alight. When Balaam came under the direction of the king to curse the children of Israel, he was unable to do it. They were uncursable. So he said, I suggest to you try another method. Use lust and desire of the flesh among the young people there. Change their thinking, take their shields away, take their armor away, and bring them into compromise, and you will defeat them. And that's exactly what the devil is doing for the church today. If the church and the individuals allow him to do so. But we are not so. We are not so. Say it with me. We are not so. We are not so. Bible says we wrestle. Greek word parley. They used to have a room in the Roman gymnasium called the palestra. And it was a training room in the arts. And the ancient world, the ancient Greek and sports that continued on with the Romans and right through the Greek and Roman world really consisted of three forms of fighting. Boxing, and the boxing was really brutal. Leather straps wrapped around the arms, sharp, even serrated edges on those things on both hands. The only rules in boxing were you're not allowed to hold the other person's gloves or hands, and there were no rounds. You just beat until the other bloke pretty much died or succumbed. And if it got down to a stalemate, you went blow for blow. That's why Paul said, I do not box as one that beats the air. He said, I don't shadow box. He said, if I'm going into a boxing match, I'm not going in there to dance around and look pretty. Very easy in the body of Christ to get up in the pulpit and dance around and look pretty. Well, you know, we can wear all the flashiest gear and have all the right terms and have... That's the only thing I never work out over the years when the American preachers came to Australia, how they were able to get every strand of hair perfect. I had none of them stay in place. They rebel. So I work on a rebellious, holy hairstyle. It's rebelling against... Mm-hmm. in the palaestra they were trained, wrestling was pretty fierce. Guys died in the ring, their backs were broken, eyes gouged. It was a brutal sport. And then Pancratoros, which is very much, I think, coming in, and who knows in the next year what it's going to be like with the cage fighting and the UFC and the stuff. Who knows where it's all going to go ultimately. Who knows if in a few years' time we don't have gladiatorial sports. You never know, do you? People would come. We've got gladiators going in our stadiums. They'd pack. No? Well, think about it. They would. They'd show up for that. People would show up. But the ancient sports, well, wrestling was one man versus another with an aim of bringing him to surrender either through some form of brutality or some hold or a submission or a choke or something that rendered him incapacitated. And the Bible says we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but we're wrestling against principalities and powers whose aim is to bring us down if we are those that are willing to be brought down. But my Bible says that we are the head, not the tail, above only, never below. We are the one in control. And if we follow the rules that God's laid out in the book, and we live by the rules and we live by the word, then we will be the head and not the tail, living in dominion. But if we drop the guard and open up the stuff we shouldn't and fill our minds with stuff we shouldn't and leave the door open, we're vulnerable to get into some arm lock or some hole that's going to cause a lot of pain. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, the Greek word arche, chief spirits. Yeah, ancient ones, been around a long time. We wrestle principalities, powers, authorities, world rulers, cosmokratoros, cosmic dominions, cosmic powers. Wicked spirits, pneumaticus poneros, wicked, malevolent, dirty little filthy demon spirits. Most people are dealing with them. They're the ones that are just yapping like little dogs. They're the ones that get in your ear, get around you, malevolent, like the flies back home. It's like summertime and you've got flies buzzing around you or mosquitoes buzzing around you. But they go in the name of Jesus with a little encouragement. They flee. And I have people come up and they say, the devil's troubling me. I say, no, he's not. It is a little undersized demon with a wooden leg, glass eye, and bad speech impediment, giving you trouble. And bad breath, just giving you trouble. Just a little small one. Really? Yes. In fact, it may be one of the really very small ones troubling. I don't think it's the devil. I mean, these people, the devil's worried. The devil doesn't even know who they are. Who was that? Paul, I know. Jesus, I know. Paul, I know. Who are you? Huh? I mean, we've got to think pretty highly of ourselves if we've got the devil after us. I think it was, who was it? It was Martin Luther woke up, and the devil had a crack at Martin Luther. He stood at the end of the bed with his red eyes and rolled out a scroll with all of his sins. And Martin Luther said, is that all? Add these, you've missed a couple. Now, right all over it, washed clean by the blood of Christ. Yeah. Then the devil came back again. And he said, not you again, and rolled over. Rolled over. But there is a wrestling. A lot of it's in the mind. A lot of it's thoughts. A lot of it's stuff. The devil, he's really, if you really want an analysis of what he's like a mouse with a megaphone. Loud. Makes scary noises. Like this little tiny mouse. Squeak. Oh, really? He's influential. And he knows his plans, but we are ahead of the game. Someone say we're ahead of the game. We wrestle against principalities' powers. Wherefore? take unto you. It's a command. Pick it up. Pick up the whole armor of God that you might stand in the evil day. And then having done all to stand, you know what that means? Having totally and completely had the victory and annihilated the enemy, stay standing ready for the next one. It's a little bit like they've come at you from every angle and you've beaten the whole lot and you go, okay, come on. Is there someone else want to take me? I know what you're thinking. I love what Paul keeps saying. Stand. Stand. Stand therefore. Stand therefore, having your loins girt. Stand therefore, having on the breastplate of righteousness. Stand therefore, having your mind guarded with a helmet. Stand therefore, taking a sharp sword that you've had on the wheel, sharpening that blade and sharpening that blade and sharpening that blade. And moreover, make sure you've got the shield of faith with which you shall quench all the fiery darts of the evil one. Let's go back. Let's go back to 2 Corinthians. You all happy tonight?
Yeah.
Who's not? I don't know how long we'll go tonight. Pastor said, see if you can go as long as a Rodney meeting. We're aiming for 5. I've been in some of Pastor Rodney's meetings where you're just about, I've been down under the power of God and gone to sleep. My wife's kicking me under the floor. But some of those meetings, I remember 2 o'clock in the morning sitting there and could hear the angels singing. Going, wow, been there 4 or 5 hours. It's like, whew. So you never know tonight, just relax. If you got kids, don't worry. They'll be all right in the morning for school. What day is it? They'll be all right for tomorrow. No, we'll get through. For the weapons of our warfare are not natural, not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down the strongholds. Last time I was here, I talked about that. I'm pretty sure I shared about strongholds, and I'll touch it briefly again and then move a different direction. The weapons of our warfare are not natural, but they are divinely powerful to the pulling down. That word pulling down means to demolish, to bring even to extinction strongholds. We're destroying speculations, reasonings. The Amplified Bible says speculations, reasonings. I think the word is logismos, which means all those things, imaginations, reasonings, logics, every high thought that man brings. We live in a society of high thought, which man thinks is higher than that of the Word of God. Humanist teaching says man is smarter than God. God, his rules are antiquated. We are writing our own. So we live in a society that is dominated and controlled by humanistic thought that says we know better than God. God doesn't know about these things. I mean, after all, who is he? Just, well, they don't think he created the universe. They think that happened from a big bang. I used to let fireworks off. I've never seen anything created letting fireworks off. I mean, we used to blow up a stick of gelignite. I've never seen anything come out of blowing. Well, when I was a kid, I shouldn't have done it, but we used to get big, threepenny, like a 3-cent bomb, cracker night, fireworks night. And they were brilliant. You drop them in on someone's letterbox. And I wasn't a Christian then. I needed Jesus badly. But you'd watch a letterbox, poof. And I let them off by the hundreds and never saw one positive thing come out of those fireworks. Not one. I mean, we're told that the earth and all the planets have come out of the sun. Well, the sun's helium and hydrogen and stuff. I'm not a scientist, so I'm on dangerous ground. But if that's happened, where did the lead, zinc, plutonium, carbon, zinc, and all the other stuff come from? Is the earth 90% different to the sun? 92.3% different. Approximately. And how come if everything got flung out from the sun, some of the moons spin the other way? How do you work that? Yeah, what a lot of hogwash. People believe anything. Believe we've come from monkeys. Mind you, a couple of my relatives, I'm a bit convinced. No, I'm not. No, man doesn't want to believe in God. Man wants to be God. And so he sets up, and we live in a society that's really basically the thoughts and the philosophies and the teachings of our society are humanistic, anti-God. So you've got strongholds being built in a generation by the mind manipulation, which it is, of music, television, movies, mind manipulation, that's raising a generation to go with the flood. To go with the flood. Go with the lot. And if you're swimming up against the rapids, there's something wrong with you. I think it was Adolf Hitler said, even if it's a big lie, if you say it often enough and strong enough, they will believe it. And the bigger the lie, the more prone they are to believe it. I challenge someone to design a human arm with all the hinges. Have you ever thought about if you said to a metal worker, I want you to design a joint that will do that, pick up anything, and attach it to a joint that'll do that, to a joint that'll do that, so that this one piece of machinery will do anything. But you're not allowed to use your intelligence. You just got a blindfold, throw it in the air and hope it lands properly. You can't use intelligence. Build a robot without intelligence. You can't. What about a biological robot that can speak, think, dream, love, reproduce? Make that. Just design one that, just a simple one, a puppet that works without using some intelligence. That intelligence is nothing. Well, it must be spacemen. Oh. Who made the spacemen? They evolved from another bang in another universe. Thank God that I might not be the brightest, the sharpest knife in the drawer. But I do believe that the only way this incredible world could come into being is with the intelligence of a creative God. Now I've forgotten what I was even telling you. Where was I up to? Imaginations, reasonings, and every... I went through the school of art. I was trained in the 60s in the school of art. I mean, I would sit in the art room with the smell of Marajuni, with the Beatles singing in the background, I am the Eggman, I am the Eggman, I am the Walrus, Roo Cooker too, I am you and you are me and we're all together, see how we run, like pigs from a gun, see how we run, I'm crying. Seven little pilchers hanging from the Eiffel Tower, man, you've been a naughty boy, you let your hair grow long. I am the Eggman, I am the Walrus, I am the Eggman, Roo Cooker. What were they thinking? Or John Lennon singing, looking through a glass onion. Have you listened to the lyrics of some of the songs of the 60s and wondered why your parents and grandparents are nuts? Johnny's in the basement mixing up the medicine. I'm on the outside thinking about the government. Girl by the whirlpool's looking for a new fool. Don't follow leaders, watch parking meters. Get fit, get well, hang around the inkwell. Hog bell early, mate. Orders from the DA. Look out, kids. You're going to get hit. A loser's cheated, a six-time loser. Telephone rang the other day, it was President whoever calling me up. He said, hey there, Bob, what do we need to make the country grow? I said, President, whatever, Bridget Bardot, Sophia Loren, Anita Ekberg, country will grow. Out of the shower came a football man, bottle of hair oil in his hand, crazy kid stuff, out the window. of drug-induced stuff and anti-God stuff. I remember you had the punks singing, I am the Antichrist, I am an Antichrist. Sex Pistols. And all these people bobbing their head, I am an Antichrist. And AC/DC, Rolling Thunder, listen to this lyrics, Rolling Thunder, driving rain, coming down like a hurricane, white lightning flashing across the sky, you're only young but you're going to die. I'll take no prisoners, I'll spare no lives, nobody's putting up a fight, I've got my bell, I'm going to take you to hell, going to get you, Satan get you, hell's bells. And you get a crowd of kids singing that with all their heart. Then when Bon Scott died, choked in his own vomit, they came back and the lyrics of their song were, I'm back in black. I got loose from the noose that kept me hanging around, I'm back in black. And the same pulse went through their music with crowds of young people caught up and their mind just being taken in the world's direction. So we are a people like Daniel living in a world that is hostile. Living in a world of Babylonic thinking, Antichrist morality, to the degree where if we even begin to speak in the future about moral issues, the chances are it'll be a criminal offense that'll put us in jail. May not be far from that now. And you can say what you like, you've got freedom of speech about anything except Christianity and Jesus. And if you take a stand, you're a hater. So if they tell me I'm a hater, I'll say, yes, I am a hater. I hate sin. I hate things that'll take you to hell. I hate the things that'll destroy you. I hate the things that'll break your family down. And God hates them. God hates divorce. He hates immorality. He hates all these things. He hates every form of sexual impurity. He hates what's happening with young people as they fill their bodies with drugs and try to find a high that only he can give. I'm a hater. Hater of sin. Hater of what destroys. Hater of what breaks families. Hater of what destroys homes. So how do we have to be? Who do we have to be in this world right now? Paul said, the weapons of our warfare are not natural, but they are divinely powerful through God to the demolition of fortresses. We are utterly destroying speculations, reasonings, and every lofty thing raised against the knowledge of God. Can I suggest to you that on this planet, in the midst of everything that's going on, one thing is going to happen in the midst of all the nonsense that will shake every philosophy and every reasoning, and that will be an undeniable manifestation of the demonstration and miraculous power of God to such a degree that people will stand there saying, how did that happen? We had a young Catholic man in our meeting on Sunday night, had scoliosis, twisted spine. And he'd come to church for the second time. He was a skeptic. He sat in the back row, and as he sat in the back row, I was preaching in a church in Virginia Beach. As he sat in the back row, his spine went straight, and he began to jump around, changed by the power of God. And then a young lady ran down the front with a deaf ear that had opened. And then a lady stood up out of a wheelchair and said, I've got growths, tumors have gone off my spine. We need to fill our society with a demonstration of power that causes people to say, "There." You know, the scripture says, the very last words that Jesus spoke, and you need to listen to his last words because last words are important. They said to him, Lord, is it at this time that you're going to restore the kingdom to Israel? He says, not for you to know times and epochs. He said, but you shall receive divine power, dunamis, divine, supernatural, miraculous capacity, after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, to bear witness of me. What does it mean to bear witness? The Greek word is martys. from which we get the word martyr. What does the word martyrs mean? It is a legal term. And literally what Jesus said was, you're going to receive a divine ability to move in the miraculous that is going to bear legal witness of the fact that I am alive and in the midst. Every miracle bears witness to the fact that he's alive. To a great degree, you can sit in churches all over the world, the Western world, and hardly have a Sunday where the sick are prayed for. But there are also churches that are getting so hungry that they are becoming quite ravenous. I have a feeling I may be in one tonight. I just have a feeling that there may be some people sitting here tonight. There may just be some, there could just be some people in this building that would say, my God, the stuff that happened with Wigglesworth, the stuff that has broken out with this one or with that one, or A.A. Allen, or A.A. Allen, under such a manifestation. Man, I'm spitting now. A.A. Allen. He's ministered not far from here, didn't he? Had his... Yeah, well, that's not that far. Just up the road and across a couple of hills, down a couple of hollows. He was ministering his crusades and the crowds were so big he didn't know how to lay hands on them all. So he said, God, what do I do? And God said, do what Peter did. Use your shadow. And they set up a spotlight behind him and they moved on a rail so that they, as he waved his hand like this, they put the spotlight on him and moved the spot so that just the light and the shadow of his hand passing over, miracles were breaking out on every side. Every side. There's no limit in this thing. Someone say there's no limit. There is no limit. There's just no limit. As in... I don't know when I saw you last, but I think I'd been in Vanuatu. I've been the last 2 years in Vanuatu. The whole nation's turned upside down. It's a small nation. The whole place has just exploded with power. But one night there, the Lord spoke to me. He said, and I've done this a number of times. I have a team with me, and God says, tell them to bring the deaf. And I think there was 35. I think I told you this last time I was here. 35 across the platform. And the Lord said to me, go to the first guy. And I started praying for this guy. And I was working hard to try and get this ear open. I thought, Lord, if this doesn't open, we're just hung out here. Really, we're hung out to dry a bit. And Jesus, come on, thank you, Lord. Let's break this thing. And all of a sudden, his ear popped open. And the next one, a couple of ears opened up. And I turned to this young man who's now working with us. You'll probably meet him in the future. And I said, Tucker. He's a Texan. His name's Tucker. His dad's name's Earl. His mum's name's Lane. And his brother's name's Bo. Bo, Tucker, Lane, and Earl. From Fort Worth, Texas. And I said, Tucker, do you believe that this girl's ear are going to open? He says, yes, sir. I said, get up here. He was filming and that sort of went... He came up and that one was healed. Then I got another one of the students, that one was healed. And we went down the line and every one of them healed, and three mutes, one of them from birth. I think several of them got the hearing and speaking. And one of them was the pastor organizing the crusaders, his daughter. And all of a sudden these kids go, hey, we can do this. And every day they're laying hands. And one of the girls came up to me this last trip and she said, Pastor, we in the hospital there was a lady and her baby had died in the womb. There was no heartbeat. They declared the baby dead in the womb. She said, we stood around and prayed and the heart started beating and the baby came alive in the womb. So the whole city is filled. Jerusalem was filled with the knowledge of a miraculous God. So great was the manifestation of the miraculous in Ephesus that just handkerchiefs and aprons carried from Paul and laid upon the sick, demons were coming out and people were getting healed left, right and center as a handkerchief was laid on them. And the whole city filled. And the impact was so great that the trade in the little silver statues of Artemis or Diana was going down the drain. And I stood there a couple of years ago at that big theatre where 50,000 cried out for 2 hours, "Great is Artemis! Great is Artemis! Great is Artemis! Great is Artemis or Diana!" And they sought to bring Paul in there. Paul wanted to go. And they restrained him. Restrained him. He was destroying the trade in that city with the power of the gospel. The greatest thing that smashes through. Daniel went into Babylon, changed his name from Daniel, Prince of God, to Belteshazzar. Belteshazzar. Prince of Bel. Belshazzar was the gentleman who had an unfortunate experience when Cyrus came to visit. Changed his name. Changed the name of the boys. Meshach, who was like Aku, the moon god. What were their names? Azariah, Hananiah, and Mishael. Mishael, who was like God. Changed it to Shadrach, who was like Aku, moon god. Changed their names. Couldn't change their heart. Tried to change their food. They weren't prepared. Couldn't change their God. No compromise. God not only gave them wisdom 10 times their peers. You live uncompromisingly for Jesus and he will give you wisdom and creativity 10 times. People say you use 10% of your brain. Well, he'll give you the whole 100%. Whole 10 yards. And then, of course, the great challenge came. I don't know if you've read much of Babylon, the city. If you go to Berlin and go down to the Museum Island, there is the Pergamum Museum. I was in Pergamum a couple of years ago, and there's the big place where the temple used to be. It was taken brick by brick, stone by stone, back to Berlin and totally reconstructed in the Pergamum Museum. You can actually walk up the steps of that the Temple of Zeus, completely restored and in their museum. It's a big museum. And then you go through the next room, and there are the gates of Babylon that have been bought over. They got all the little stones, found everything, bought them back and probably fired them again, and all numbered and put together, and you can walk through the Ishtar Gates. They've got the front section of the Ishtar Gates, and they've got all the stones to build the back section, which would be probably higher than this building by far. I guess the gates would be, the first set of gates would be about up to the top of these windows, and you can walk in through those gates, and there's Marduk and Bel, and even on the side is the inscription from Nebuchadnezzar. So you can walk through those gates, but Daniel walked into a nation that was built around interpretation of dreams and visions with the Chaldeans, that particular group of people who by birth were very high in their position, and the magicians and the magi. And so great was his impact that he not only saved all their skins by interpreting the dreams of King Nebuchadnezzar, not only was his power to interpret great, that after the second dream of Nebuchadnezzar, he interpreted the dream of him eating grass and so on. So powerful was the interpretation. Not only was he made the head of the Magi. Do you remember it was the Magi, the wise men that came at Christmas? I wonder when he had become the head of the Magi, whether God didn't give him a revelation and say to those Magi, "I have another word from the great God who answers and shows secrets. There will come a time when there will be a great star to follow. And when you follow it, you'll find the one that I've been telling you about." And it was the Magi. When they went into a nation, came into a nation, the nation was terrified because they changed governments with their prophetic power. They had an impact. They brought troops with them. Well, they didn't go straight down to the stable with three little gifts and a nice hat on a camel. They came into town with an army and an entourage. And when they came in, the Bible says the whole of Jerusalem was trembling, particularly Herod. Herod was terrified. When these guys come to town, they come meaning business in the realm of the spirit. These guys change and impact nations in their leadership. And they said, "We follow this star." Herod said, "When you find him, come that I might worship him." He was probably 2 years of age when they found Jesus. They came to him. I think the Christmas story's a little, but we'll stick with it so we can have our little nativity thing. Won't we, Reverend? Comfortable? Good. Thank you very much. I wonder if they were coming because Daniel, head of the Magi, had been talking to them about hearing from the Most High God. And had a, somehow they knew. It's interesting. Simon, there in Samaria, he was a Magi. It's the word from which we get magic. He was given the head position. Then so great was the impact of his interpretation of dreams that we've got a whole chapter in Daniel chapter 4 that is the testimony of the greatest despot ruler in the world declaring that through the stance of a young man that came from a defeated and broken city, that the strength, the authority and the anointing on this young man was so great that I, Nebuchadnezzar, and you can read it in your own time, I, Nebuchadnezzar, declare, effectively, I have embraced anyone that speaks out against the God. I declare to every nation on the earth. Effectively, he declared, I have been won over and I now accept him as the God. Because of the influence of a young boy about 16 who over a few years had so impacted through the supernatural manifestation of the power of God that they could not deny the reality. Babylon, changed by a 16-year-old boy. America right now needs an uncompromising generation who will stand with a hunger for the supernatural. Not a hunger for ministry, a hunger for the supernatural. Hallelujah. 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 Is there such a hungry person here tonight? Is there one? Is there one? Jesus. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. What a profound God we serve. What a mighty God. This is not the time to let the lies of the devil say your circumstances make it impossible. The devil will give you 58 million reasons why you can't do it. You say, you don't know my situation, what I'm facing. You don't know the opposition I get in my home. You don't know that when I go home from here, I have a situation that's pretty much impossible. Well, this is where God steps in. When you don't compromise, watch God step into your situation with a ferocity. When God begins to mean business, that's the time to step aside. You say, well, my situation's impossible. Peter was in prison in the deepest recesses of the jail, facing death. Straight after they let him live through the festival, the feast. And they were going to kill him straight after. The church was fervently praying, and as they fervently prayed, the angelic host began to move. Something happens when we pray. We underestimate what happens. Fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. As they prayed, Peter's chains fell off. The jailer fell down. The door swung open. The angel said, "Come on, Peter." They went past. Jailers under the power of God, and the door locked shut after them. Through the first gate, second gate, up to the main gate, and he walked out of the prison. There's not a prison that can be built that can keep God from breaking you out. Because he's the one mighty to the demolition of fortresses. God. Thank you. Jesus. Touches. There's a whole room full of people here that I reckon any of you really like to have a touch from God tonight? Well, I think that's a majority. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to get the pulpit carrying brethren. Sorry about that comment before. You're okay with that? Have you? No complaints? I don't think so. I'm glad because you're pretty big and I didn't want to get hurt. That was the big thing. Jesus. How many people have a name that starts with M? All right, you come down to the front. We'll pray for you first. I'm writing my book on the amazing animal alphabet, so I'm really... How many starting with N come? And Z. When it catches, guys, I need quick click. That's it. Just take it all. Just let God. We don't have to do much. Just watch him. We don't have to do much tonight. We just have to watch. Just watch people here. Just brothers, just watch people here. Watch this young man. He's a great mate of mine, this one. Jesus, I love watching these kids growing up. Some of them still like the odd cartoon. Hannah still likes one. She's 24. Jeez. Jonathan's got a book full. You're a good young man. What's your name again? Michael, that's the power of God on you right now. That's the anointing. That's God at work within you like a holy fire from heaven. Jesus. There's really nothing on earth like the presence of God. Nothing. There it is. Take it all. Just everyone starting with O may come. Jesus. If you need healing, just take it. Just take, watch him, guys. I want this front row, please. General, bring your troops. our hands up. Father, in mighty anointing. Mighty Jesus touch. Jesus touch him. Touched. Take it all. Take it all. Fire from heaven. What's his name again? Oh, good name. You going to call him Little Zeke? Big Zeke. Jesus. 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 Power from heaven and gifts of the Holy Ghost and some healing in your body right now. Power from heaven. That's, stay with me, guys. Stay right with me. Power from heaven. Stay right with me, Jesus. Breakthrough for you, Jesus. That will happen. It will happen. Jesus. Jesus. Just feel free to come. If, just as you're hungry, don't rush everybody, but just another dozen, and then another lot. Just as you're really feeling hungry, come. I just have to pray for everybody in the place. And if you need a miracle, just take it as you're here. Just take your healing. Jesus. Just take your healing. Just take your healing. Take. Jesus. Jesus. Well, hello, Lizzie. Jeez. Auntie Lizzie. Finest auntie you'd ever meet. Jesus. Jesus. Jesus, the anointing. You got to keep a goat track for me, guys. Can I just sneak past a little one? Just give, it's a little bit of room there, that's it. I take up a lot of room. Like when I come through, it's like a school bus. Father, thank you. Jesus. Fire! Jesus.
As the eyes of the Lord search to and fro.
Jesus. Guys, Jesus.
As the eyes of the Lord search throughout the nation,
well done. Jesus. Guys,
as the Lord seeks for men, sorry, can rushing might.
Filled with power. Yeah.
As the Lord calls.
Drunk on the new wine. Drunk on the new wine and filled. Hey, sister.
Fill us with the sun.
Jesus.
Rushing might. Of the Lord Most High, the working of His power, as the eyes of the Lord go to and fro throughout the earth, rushing mighty. Arise with healing in your wings. Arise with power and authority. Stand boldly and proclaim these words of life. In the midst of a mighty rushing wind. Let your fire fall. Fire of God now burning. Fire of God now being seen. Fire of God now burning. Fire of God now being seen. Let your fire fall. Lord, take hold of me. Lord, take hold of me. I wanna be, Lord, make me. I wanna be, Lord, use me. Lord, take hold of me. The rushing mighty wind. Rushing mighty wind. Fire. Fire of God burning me, rushing mighty wind. I'm thine, O Lord, and I only want to be. I'm thine, O Lord, you look at me. Rushing mighty wind. Lord, take hold of me. I'm thine, O Lord, and I only want to be. Lord, take hold of me. Let your fire fall. Let your fire burn in me. Oh God, to rushing mighty. The eyes of the Lord go to and fro in a rushing mighty wind. I'm thine, O Lord, and I only want to be. I am thine, O Lord, O Lord, take all of me. In a rushing mighty wind. Let your fire burn in me. Oh God, take hold of me. Oh Lord, my God, take hold of me. Cause me, Lord, to be. Rush. I am thine, O Lord, all I want to be. I am thine, O Lord, and it's all I want to be. Lord, take hold of. Lord, take hold of me. Let your let me fully be. Everything you're looking for, Lord, take hold of me. All I want to be is everything you're looking for. God, take hold of me. Let your fire burn. Let your fire burn. Lord, take hold of me. I am thine, O Lord, and it's all I want to be. Rushing mighty wind, rushing mighty wind. The eyes of the Lord go to. Show his mighty power. Lord, take hold of me. Lord, I want to be so sensitive. Lord, take hold of me. Let your fire fall. Let your fire burn in me. Once again, just like you've done before. Let your mighty works be seen. Lord, take hold of me. Lord, take hold. Of the Lord go to and fro. Lord, take hold.
Out to him.
If you can flip the top, that'd be thank you. Well, praise God. Let him just touch you. I just feel such an anointing. How have you been, Stuart? You've been doing good? I want to have a chat with you about dynasties. I was talking to Mark about your studies. Interesting to talk. The Dariuses and all that, the Xerxes and... He's the Savior of my soul, my Jesus, My Jesus, you're the Savior of my soul. You're the Savior of my soul. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. Isn't he wonderful? Isn't he wonderful? Isn't he wonderful? He is everything. He is, in Genesis, he's the seed of the woman. In Exodus, he's the Passover lamb. Leviticus, he's our high priest. Numbers, pillar of cloud by day and fire by night. Deuteronomy, prophet like unto Moses. Joshua, captain of our salvation. I've forgotten a few of them. Otherwise, I just go right through it. But if you give me my Bible there for a moment, Cade, I'll trade you. Let me have that. I'll have a swig. And if you get me my Bible. It's amazing how two hydrogen atoms and an oxygen atom feel so good. But who is the fourth man in the burning fiery furnace? People don't know who the fourth man is. He's Abraham's ram. Isaac's well, Hezekiah's sundial, John's pearly white gates, Paul's handkerchiefs and aprons, and a whole lot of other wonderful things. Sometimes you just want to delight in him. If I had a red shirt on right now, I'd just lie down up here and do a Ayers Rock imitation on the platform. Ayers Rock. But I won't be doing that, because I may never get up again. Just put your hand on the shoulder of the person next to you and just say, did you know that you are incredibly wonderful? When God made you, he was impressed. He thinks you are phenomenal. He just is in raptures over you. He just watches you and watches you. You know, there's a young boy who was really concerned because he'd been a bit naughty. And he said, Dad, does God watch me all the time? He said, son, he can't take his eyes off you. Just like Cade cannot take his eyes off little Ezekiel, Frederick, Harold, Ralph. And I can't either. He is just sensational. Have a look at him in his Where's Wally outfit. Everyone that was wondering, where's Wally? We found him. There he is. And his name's Ezekiel. I guarantee when he's over at home, Pastor Mark, that tough bushman, that man of strength and authority, will melt like a little, he'll melt and make all sorts of weird noises, and all of the doctorates and studies go out the window, and it's like little funny baby noises. Only babies can reduce grown men to complete imbeciles. But that's how God is with us. He cannot take his eyes off you. I look at some of you, I mean, just looking around, you can see it, because every one of you is just unbelievably special. Everyone, I come here and I got stories with half of you. Half of you kids, now you're all grown up, 6'5". I remember when you're 3'1". Pastor Tim, can you draw a crocodile with its leg caught in a rabbit trap? All right. And there'd be a lineup of kids, and I'm thinking, God, I don't know if I'm going to survive. The preaching was hard going. I worked hard there, but it's the drawing that exhausts me. And then they'd be out there ratting the paper, and on Monday when the PA needed to get some paper in the printer, there's none there. It's all gone. What a joy. Well, I'm still a bit jet-lagged. You probably about had it. It's been really nice to share with you tonight. I don't know what we'll do tomorrow night. I'm sure God's got a plan, so I'm really keen to come and find out what it is. It's been fun sharing with you. Have you enjoyed yourself tonight? Yeah. It's just good. I feel like I'm just having family time. I don't actually feel like I'm here ministering. I feel we're just, you know, sitting around like family going,
I remember when I was just a young fella. I used to go over there to San Diego with all the kids there.
Probably another 20 years, I'll be this really old fella. Another 20 years, I'll be 88, pushing 90. And I'll come in here.
Thanks so much, Pastor Mark, for the privilege of having me preach the gospel to the saints. And we got elections coming up. And Jim Carrey's running for president.
We can enjoy God. We can enjoy God. We can enjoy each other. It's just special. Like, I don't know what I'm supposed to be doing. There's people watching at home going, But it's a reunion. I see all these little kids growing up. Some of them have been just wicked enough to be away and missing the night. But we'll forgive them. Forgive them. Amen. Just, you get into an atmosphere in the Lord, and you don't want to walk out of it, really. You want to enjoy it. You know, the scripture comes, Jesus said, Lord, that they might be one. Even as we are one. And you feel that tonight, don't you? I do. I just feel like I'm one of the bigger ones. Little Zeke's one of the smaller ones, but we're just one. We're just here enjoying each other, one in the Spirit. Aren't we, Brad? We've had some fun. We've walked over aircraft carriers and got around eating a lot of Mexican food. I was quite skinny till I found that restaurant. Jesus. Anyway, Pastor Mark, just a joy to be back. I can't think of anything else to do right now except hand back to the Right Honourable Dr. Marcus Aurelius Maximus Spitzbergenus.
Okay, we'll be back here tomorrow night at 7 o'clock, okay? And bring someone with you. Bring someone with you. Someone with you needs an encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ, needs an encounter with the power of the Holy Ghost, who needs to be healed, who needs to have a touch from heaven. You'll find somebody. If you look hard enough and you ask enough people if they want to have an encounter with God and a touch from heaven, I promise you, you're going to find somebody that's going to be a taker. And so I pray in Jesus' name you'll do that. You'll find somebody. Bring them to the meeting tomorrow night. Be here Thursday night. Once again, Friday night. Don't miss a single night. Find a bunch of people around you. Tell them that you love them. Bless them. But let's go ahead and also worship the Lord with their giving, because we want to participate with what Tim's doing all over the world. So worship the Lord with giving. Just bless the Lord. Always have something in your hand to give. Always bring something to the Lord.